ever thought about all that happened between Nazareth and Bethlehem? It was quite a journey. Mary's faithfulness was transformed to fulfillment, and Joseph's anxious heart to one of trust and commitment. Through eyes of humility, they witnessed the miracle of the ages firsthand. Bethlehem, always thought of as that sleepy little town, was anything but that on the night Mary and Joseph arrived. They were welcomed by noisy crowds, busy streets, and one tired, impatient innkeeper.
I can't believe what a night this has been. We've never been this busy before. My rooms, they're all full, yet they're still coming in. Why, some are even sleeping on the floor. Don't get me wrong, but I've had a bad day. I'm not the unemotional kind. I see that your wife is in a family way. You're welcome to the stable out behind. Shining so bright, how come I've never seen it before? And why does it seem like this beacon of light is reaching from the heavens to my door?
It in 100 different ways. In the sweep of his arm as he set the stars in the heaven, the roar of the Red Sea as he parted it, and the gentle note from the harp of a shepherd boy, or in the thunder of a giant as he crashed to earth. This is a history of a God that delights in surprising us with glimpses of his glory when we least expect it, but perhaps none so amazing as that night so long ago when he chose to come to, of all places, a stable in a little town called Bethlehem.
There he was, the answer to generations of prayers, the hope of a waiting nation, the living fulfillment of an ancient promise. There he was, with 10 fingers and 10 tiny toes, a small, fragile vessel of God's infinite power. In him, all the hopes and dreams of men and angels were realized. And while the world slept unaware, the heavens broke forth in rejoicing.
God had kept his promise. The Messiah had come. Now, surely this was the greatest news. It should have been announced in the temple. Could have been proclaimed in town squares. The King of Kings could have come riding in with his armies to banish Caesar and his soldiers for good. But God chose to come quietly in the night. Not on Main Street or in a fine home, but out back in a stable. Only a few animals to attend him. A sheep, a cow, a young carpenter and his wife, and a band full of shepherds, the only ones who knew that God's glory had broken upon the earth.
Thank you.
Perhaps God knew that those with power would be too protective of their positions to welcome a new king. For those with great wealth would be too busy making their fortunes to answer his call. But certainly he intended that only those who would see him through eyes of faith would be able to behold his coming. For temple leaders and wise men were confounded by him, while fishermen and tax collectors would drop everything to follow him. The shepherds would be the first to seek him, and then many others would come asking, "Who is this Jesus?" And how they answered would change their lives forever.
Somebody told me there's a baby in a manger.
Tell me who this child is.
Somebody told me there's a star above a stable.
Tell me who this child is. Somebody told me there were angels in the heavens singing glory to his name. Somebody tell me who this child is.
What about those who missed his glory? Well, the Apostle Paul warned that perilous times would come, when people would be lovers of themselves, lovers of pleasure, rather than lovers of God. having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof. And so people starve in Somalia, kill each other in Bosnia, cheat one another on Wall Street, and murder their children on Main Street. Peace has indeed been elusive. Yet the promise of this little child, the Prince of Peace, remains the only hope for all who will just trust him.
This world remains the same. Empires have been built and fallen. Only time has made a change. Nation against nation, brother against brother. Men so filled with hatred, killing one another. And over half the world is starving, while the banner of decency is torn. Debating over disarmament, killing children before they're born, and fools who march to win the right to justify their sin. Oh, every nation that has fallen from within.
angel told the shepherds, go see him. And once they had, they rushed out to tell everyone what they had been told about this little child. And the risen Jesus told his disciples, you shall be my witnesses, and then sent them out to every corner of the earth. What about we who have seen him? You have seen Jesus, haven't you? We need to tell the world about the hope we have, the hope that they can have too. Because when everything else seems hopeless, the promise of the King of Kings still remains the only hope for a hurting world. And how will they hear if we don't tell them?
Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and
o'er silent flocks by night. Behold, throughout the heavens there shone a holy light.
We got to go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere.
We got to go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born.
God had come to us, but only a few would recognize him. As the scripture had foretold, he came to his own, and his own received him not. God chose to forsake the glory of heaven and walk among us, knowing that he would be despised and rejected. See, from the moment that that star first shone its light upon the stable, the shadow of the cross was cast upon the earth. The baby in that manger was born, but for one reason: to die for all of us.
Heavenly.
child and yet a king, born to be an offering, born in a humble stall, and yet born to be Lord of all. And what made him walk that road to carry our sinful load? And what was the reason he bore it alone? Glorious
glory. A weakened rag of a man, beaten almost beyond recognition, stumbling blindly past jeering crowds, too weak to carry his own cross. King Jesus, a wreath of thorny briars, his only crown, hung up to die like a common thief.
Thank you.
On that dark afternoon, God's glory stretched from one end of the sky to the other, but only a handful of people saw it. A centurion on the hillside whispered in awe, "Surely this must have been the Son of God." A thief dying beside Jesus saw it and found the door to heaven. But most never realized it in the crowd. They'd been looking for a leader, not an outlaw, a king, not the Prince of Peace. They never expected God's glory to be found in a stable or in a child's simple lunch of fish and loaves or walking upon the sea or hung up upon a cross. And what about you and me? Are we so different? God's glory is flung before us in 1,000 different colors every day. The gold of autumn, the green of spring, the laugh of a child or the face of a friend. In a hospital room, at the kitchen sink, in the noise of traffic, God's glory is all around us. Whether we see it or not depends upon what we're looking for.
My baby graduated this year, and I've had to let her go and let her spread her wings. And it's so hard, Father, when we've protected her for so long. But then I'm reminded, Father, that you let go of your Son to come to earth for us. Oh, how you must love us. In this new year, Father, help me to lean upon your strength and to move closer to you for all my needs. In Jesus' name.
With the invitation of friends, I attended Southland's Easter ministry. I sat right there in the balcony. I didn't come that night to get ministered to. I came to be entertained. But when I saw Jesus Christ raised on that cross, I had to face how far that I had drifted from the Lord. That's when I asked the Lord not to let me die before my life was right with Him. Jesus is faithful.
It's always been a symbol of salvation, but for me, it became a symbol of hope during the Easter ministry of 1984. While finishing the structural steel base for the cross used in our Easter ministry, my father had a heart attack and died. What a fitting exit for a man who spent his entire life holding the cross up for others to see. Lord, remind us that your glory and our hope is in the finished work of Calvary.
And so this Christmas, as at every Christmas, we celebrate the glory of Christ. light of his glory still shines on us. It brightens up our everyday places where he dwells with us today, just as he did in that manger so long ago. And it illuminates tomorrow with hope and joy, for he has promised that when he comes again, we will see him in all of his glory.
for participating with Southfield Christian Church through the Southfield Hour. If you would like teaching from the Bible or how to make Jesus Christ the Lord and Savior of your life, please write to the Southfield Hour, Post Office Box 24243, Lexington, Kentucky 40524.